thing that matters whether you make a profit or loss is
price. Nothing else. The only time you ask a question is when you don't make money. When you make money, happy. There is no analysis. Why did you make money is never asked. When you lose money, however, what went wrong, what was wrong with the analysis, blah, 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 blah. Whether you do sentiments or do SA or you do RBI policy or Greece calls or whatever it is. Alright, fine. The only thing that matters to you is price. You know what? Most of us pretend it doesn't matter. A lot of us analyze a lot but refuse to look at price. So this company's stock price will go up. Don't worry. It's just temporary. It will, you know, good quality company. Well, let's have a short discussion on this. Markets versus analysts versus the media versus you. Okay. Who wins, who loses? It's a very well-known fact that most retail investors and traders do not make money in the long term. There's a website called Morningstar.com. Right? It's one of the world's best websites for independent mutual fund research. You know what mutual funds do? Marketing data. And then from year to year, if you had invested with us, you would have made 40%. Correct? A lot of us have seen that. A lot of us have invested on that. This is a different question. That is what the mutual fund's performance is. How much did the average retail investor in that mutual fund make during any point in time? That's a whole different question. Right? And Morningstar did a research on this. The average investor in a mutual fund, this is US data, made 1/10 of what the mutual fund itself made. So if you bought into, let's say, a Sensex fund when it was 10,000 and it became 20,000, oh, you can be very happy and say, I would have made 100%. But only if you got in at 10,000 and got out at 20,000, right? When did you get in? When did the neighbor next to you get in? When did your relative get in? When did they get out is what matters to you. When you look at that data, the reality is very, 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 very different. Most retail folks make a fraction, if anything, of what the system does or a fund does. How many of you watch...
Then who made the remaining 9/10 of that?
Yeah, 10 of you made 1/10, 1/10, 1/10, 1/10, 1/10. All of you made 100. I'm interested in what I made. Are you really interested in what your neighbor makes? Let's be honest. I don't think so. Right? Now, how many of you want to watch the blue channels? Which are the blue channels? Yeah, business channels. CNBC. Some of you are looking. Right? CNBC, ET Now, blah, blah, blah. January 2008, when Sensex hit 20,000, what did you see on the channels? Did you see birthday cakes being cut? Right? Udyan Mukherjee wore a cap. There were balloons floating around. Right? It was all festive atmosphere and everybody was very happy. And everybody said 30,000, 40,000, 50,000, whatever it is. Right? Did anybody tell you to sell?
No.
Right? Okay. 9 months later, we were at 7,697. Did anyone tell you to buy? What did they say instead? Where will the market go? 5,000, 4,000, 3,000. And of course, bunch of us here sitting and thinking, I should have. Yeah. How many should have in life? Because here's one thing, you can't go back in the past, you always have to deal with where you are right now and what could happen next. And that's exactly what TA is about, I'll come to that in a little while. My point is this, you and I listen to the so-called experts, are we better off for it? Or are we worse off for it? And what comes in the way of you acquiring that sort of knowledge so that you can make that sort of money for yourself? That's what I hope to highlight in today's session, right? So just a few examples of some stocks. Suzlon, DLF, the .com, right? Okay, let's just have a look. not to teach any technical analysis here today. Whose loan was once upon a time 400? Right? Even when it went IPO, it was considered very expensive, but even after that it continued to go up. So then everybody was very happy. Right? Tanti was front page news all over the place. Getting this order, getting that order. Right. After 2008 mid and it started sliding down, today it's at its life low almost. You can say anything you want about Suzlon. They had an engineering problem, they recovered from it, they're getting new orders, FA is improving, blah 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 blah. If you bought the stock at 200 or 300 and it is 17 rupees 95 paisa now, when will it go back to your 400 rupee price? Correct, only God knows. No one else knows, only God knows. Right? The point is this, however good a company may be, you cannot fight the market. If the market feels this price has to go down, this price has to go down. You can do what you want, you can pray, you can do. As a medical doctor, this is the analogy I give in my courses. You know, if you prick your finger here, what will you get? You get blood. If you take a drop of blood and put it under a microscope, what will you see? Anyone seen those cells? Red blood cells? Right? All small, teeny, weeny things. And this is the body. This whole sharir. Right? You and I are that RBC. This is the body. The problem is this. This RBC thinks it knows what the body is doing. Is it really possible? This RBC thinks, you know what? I'm going up because this finger is going up. But if the hand is going down, what's the whole point? This RBC, by the way, I'm talking about you. Right? You and I think, oh, all this thinking analysis can influence the market, it will go up. Nobody gives a damn about you or about me. Let's get that very, very clear. The market will teach you that. Right? A lot of us get white hair and die without understanding that. Hopefully you will understand that when you still have some grey hair. Then you will live a much better life. Let's take another example. Here is Hindustan Unilever. Once upon a time, in 1999-2000, a prime company of India's stock market, then got hit by all sorts of competition. When in 2006 or 2007 peak came, it was still back to its 1999 dot-com boom sort of peak. It had never made a life high. Today, if you watch TV, you will hear almost all the analysts say, what? We are going to sell FMCG stocks. Why? Because they are expensive. They are this PE, they are that PE. Fine, okay, sell. What is Hindustan Unilever doing? It's making new life highs. And it continues to make life highs. I won't get into technicals today, but if I put a simple trend line there, this trend line will not break even if it falls to 350. And for all you know, this will keep going up and up, maybe 500 or 600. I'm not saying this, the market is saying this. You and I use the word, I will do this. The market will go up. Right? This stock will go up. As though anybody or God is listening to you and say, oh, what Musa says will happen. How many things in your life that you say will happen have happened? Honestly, follow the chart. Do what the market tells you to do. If you and I had listened to our fathers and mothers properly, we would have been a much better place in life. Agreed? We realize it too late now. What to do? They don't listen. What to do? Right? When my father told me study, I said, Mark Twain has a quote. Right? I was amazed. I don't know the full proper quote. I was so shocked that my father was so foolish when I was 18. And when I was 28, I was amazed how much he knew. Who grew up? The father or the son? Right? Follow the market. You have if you don't get one thing in life, which is humility, the market will give it to you. I promise you that. After you get humility, you follow the chart. Till then you will say, it has to go down. This is a reversal pattern. Nothing is there. It's a nice uptrend. Right? Just a simple highlight of two stocks which are in two completely different areas. I just put up some more as examples, but I think these two will do for now. One at its life low and the other one at its life high. What are you going to do in a market like this? Who are you going to listen to? And my point is this, why listen to anyone? Why don't you just listen to yourself and listen to what the market is telling you to? This is a real example of real trades done. Forget about the details. How many of you would like to make $100 into $1.9 million? When I started in the morning and said, how many of you are serious traders? There were some half the crowd. Now when I put this, everybody. You know, you see stuff like this, you get skeptical, you wonder where the catch is, and you all become mice after that. Till then you say, So let's look at this. This is not my stuff. If you have this book called Edwards and McGee, which is actually the Bible of door theory, if you don't, pick it up, read it. Don't read it as one novel. It will take you 3 months to read the first time if you're reading it. It's not an easy book to read. 800 pages. Right? On chapter 5.1 of edition 9, the early editions don't have this. This is what is there in that book. A buy and hold investor who likes to doze off after buying, fill it and shut it, or forget about the stock market after it's gone 1,000, 2,000 points down, those sort of people, I know many of us are here, we won't admit, but we are here, right? Who bought $100 worth of the Dow Jones index at the historic low of 29.64 in 1897, no typos, alright, everything is factually correct, in 1897 and sold at the high of January 2000 dot-com boom, right? At 11,767 would have his initial $100 become $39,000. Okay? Long only. Buy it, put it in your inheritance and will and forget it. Because that's almost some 100 years plus, no? So your grandchildren will see this money. Okay. On the other hand, a door theory investor who bought and sold as per strict interpretation of the rules. There was a discussion that happened on BIC when I put this up. Oh, you're making this back fit and this and that and all. I said, okay, fine, take the most conservative interpretation. A trend breaks only after certain criteria are met. You will not get out before that, even if you lose money. Right? If you take the most conservative interpretation of door theory rules and would have traded both ways, long and short, then on 1st of January 2006, when the book was published, his original $100 would be $345,000. That's almost 10 times more than your long only. For an investor trader who used the same strict interpretation of the rules of door theory and went long and short from 1897 to 2006, sorry, the first one was long only, right? So you got in, when it got you to exit, you got out, sat on cash, went long again, right? Then you made $345,000. If you went long and short, your $100 would have become $1.9 million. Chapter 5.1 in McGee has each and every trade listed on it. It's not just a summary, this is just a summary. There's a 5-page table there, each and every trade, at what price you entered, at what price you exited, on what date you did that, how much profit and loss was there for each trade, the whole table is there, go and have a look. Right? The reader who listens carefully will hear the meta message here. For the great majority of investors, it is the long run which is important, and above is but an example of what can be achieved. In the right now culture of the internet and get rich quick, one wonders if there are still such investors, traders,
outside the very rich and the very intelligent. I'm not one of them yet. But there is hope that there are new converts to this approach. Are you part of this group? Because most of us, I was like this, and I meet a lot of people who are too short-term focused and then just completely miss the big picture. This is a big picture. Alright, some more stuff about this. Probably many of us will agree that far too many of us spend far too much time in life running about one thing, which is what? Money. That's why you're here also today, right? Make some money out of some ideas. But in reality, the real thing to nurture and be really careful with is one's time. How many regrets have you had about what you did not do, should have done, and can't do now because too late, too old, blah blah blah. Right? To spend that time with the people and the activities that really add deep, meaningful value to your life. Anybody knows your appointment date with Yamraj? No. Neighbor will die, I'll be fine. Right? That's really how we live. The markets taught me one thing: to deal with uncertainty. Because you really don't know what's going to happen. You can only have certain probabilities. I'll talk about that later. Well, there's a certainty called death. What are you doing about it? What am I doing about it? Is it possible to create wealth and have ample time in our lives to pursue the things that really make a difference? Which is spending time with your family and friends and everyone. Can you really do that? How many of us are stuck in 12-hour jobs, including travel time, Saturday and Sundays for washing clothes, washing the house, getting the groceries, and if you can, sleep half a day so that you can work the next week? I'm not condemning it, right? But are they alternatives? Are we aware of this? In the previous example of that $100 to $1.9 million, between 1897 to 2006, there were a total of 39,000 odd days, okay? Total duration. Of these, 37% of the time, 14,000 days, for the dough investor, the money was not in the market. Where was the money then? If it was not in the market, where was it? Sitting in the bank. Why was it in the bank? There was no opportunity which was worth taking in the market. Simple. That's it. You know, too many of us have kuchki. I have to trade. I have to do something. 60% of the time your money was not in the market. That 40% you were getting FD rate or whatever it is, put in a liquid fund, and you still made this much money. Some more data. Further, in the 109 years from 1897 to 2006, there were only 74 trades. That's an average of one trade every 1.5 years. One trade every 1.5 years. If there are any brokers here, they'll not be happy with this data. I know there are some brokers here. If you show this to your clients, you'll have to shut your shop first. And there was one trade in which the dough investor went long in 1990 and stayed long till 1998. 8 full years where you did not exit the market and you were 100% invested in the market. What were you doing all this time then? You had to wait 8 years till the trend changed. On an average, there was 1.5 year gap between one entry, another exit, another entry. So what were you doing in between? Seeing charts. Anything else? Seeing charts can become very boring after some time. Anyone who's done proper charting, it's like, oh boy, okay. Thumbs again, head and shoulders again, supporters again, this again, that. Human beings are very bad at doing something which is monotonous. It's losing interest. No matter how much money you can make out of it, you will not do it. That's why they say algo trading, system trading, this, that, not. I mean, that's a different issue. What were you doing during this 8 years or 1.5 years?
You have modified the system for defining further.
What systems? No theory rules. Here's my problem, nothing personal. You and I think we are too smart.
No, that's the problem. Only
just follow growth theory. I'm not advocating growth theory. I'm just giving an example. Just follow simple time-honored rules which have worked for 300 years, and this is the result you get.
So all the tinkering you can do maybe as a hobby, but to create serious wealth isn't required. So what are you going to do in this time?
Take the loan, not the profit, the money, and enjoy.
Yeah, when the market goes down, have fun means what? So there's one, you know, there's some phrases that I have developed because of my experience in the markets. One of them is, doing nothing is doing a lot. Because you're doing nothing, no? For 8 years you're doing, you will really, I promise you, how many of you have had a forced holiday? Where the boss said, go home, we'll pay you. TV don't call you, just stay at home, your salary will come. Anyone had that experience? No? You should have it. You really should have it. Because when you have holidays, there is this list that you have. I will do this, I will do that, and every holiday, okay, is rush, 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 rush. And then one fine day, there will be one bundle in Bangalore, and that day will be free. All those things that you had to do, that list is gone. Have you noticed? That day is a complete waste. You really don't do much. Now try and imagine that for 8 years. For 8 years, you did not have a boss who said, come home, come to work, you did not have a place to go. What could you do with yourself? A lot of us want free time, but be careful what you ask for. If you really get free time, most of us don't know what to do with ourselves. We really haven't found what we would really like to spend our time on. Life structures your life so that 8 hours in the office, 2 hours on the road, 1 hour at home, weekends washing and cleaning. No, life is that. Right? So that question at the end, what does this really mean for you and me if we really get on this path? How does it impact your life? How many of us are really practicing something like this? How many of us really will? Because we, all of us know a lot. How much of what we really know do we actually use is my question. At least for this session, only as far as the markets are concerned. So before I go on, we talked a lot about the past. Let's talk about the future a bit. All of you have got new ATMA notepads, right? So let's put them to good use. Where will the Sensex be on 1st of January 2020? Put it down. Don't worry, I won't ask you. Some of you know, some BIC faces here. So those who know, don't tell others. But others, I'm serious. Put your number down on that piece of paper. Do this exercise. 1st of January 2020, where will the Sensex be? And where do you think the Sensex will be 1st of January 2030? Anyone wants to volunteer any numbers? I promise you, much better to be foolish here than be foolish in the markets. Some of you are giving some knowing smiles. And you know what?
30 and 1 lakh.
Huh?
30 and 1 lakh.
30,000 in 2020, 1 lakh in 2030.
Yes.
All right. Anyone else?
50,000 and 1 lakh.
Anyone else? Oh, all you fellows who put the hands up when I asked you, are you traders? Give me numbers.
30,000, 45,000.
Anyone else?
45 and 75.
All right. So let me give you not my numbers, but what the market's numbers are. So let's get some perspective on this. This is the chart of the Sensex from 1980. How much was the Sensex in 1980? 130. If anybody had told you at that time, 130 on the Sensex would be 1000 on the Sensex, would you have believed it? No, right? It went to 600 in 1986. In 6 years, the Sensex went up 4 times. In 6 years, right? When the Sensex was at 600, if somebody said 1000, now maybe you would have believed it. If somebody told you it had gone to 5000, would you have believed it? Probably not. 1986, 600. 1992, another 6 years later, it went to 3,000.
Right? 5 times in 6 years. No active trading. If you just dumped your money here and left it, this is your result. There was no Sensex ETF at that time, but now they are. After that, the Sensex went and stayed range bound between 4,500 in 1994. Stayed range bound between 4,500 in 1994 till even 2001, it was 3,500. So for almost 10 years, the Sensex basically did nothing. If you were tracking the market, you would have given up. You would have said, India, blah, 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 nothing happens. Not making money. If I put my money in an FD, you're getting 14-15% at that time. I would have made a lot more money. Absolutely right. And then, around 2002, the Sensex was still 3,000. And by the way, it was 3,000 in 1993 also. So after 11 years, 10 years, it is still at the same level. How do you make money? When it was at 3,000, after maxing out at 4,500 for 10 years, if somebody had told you it would go to 10,000, would you have believed it? Because your 10 years of history is telling you, you know, even 5,000 you can't hold. That's how to tell you 10,000. What happened? It went from 3,000 in 2002 to 20,000 in 2008. In 6 years, it went up how much? 7 times. That's 1x per year almost. Alright? This is where we are today. This is updated to yesterday or Friday. Right? Now, there are two lines in this chart. There is the pink line and there is the green line. Do you really know what this chart is about? What chart is this? Is it just the Sensex? This is 32 years of India's history. That is what people don't get. 32 years of everything that has happened in India. And when I say everything, I really mean everything. When Ambi and Padmini was the only car, and who will get it was a matter of litigation in the High Court after the father died. When you waited 10 years to get your ITI telephone connection, you did not know what a mall is. Black and white TV, and if you had Chitrahar, you were the king of the mall with a color TV. You remember those days? Some are too young to remember all this. Right? When Indira Gandhi got assassinated, Rajiv Gandhi got assassinated, Ketan Parekh came and went, Harshad Mehta came and went, you had Bihar floods every year, Russia was our favorite ally, right? Kargil has come and gone. The Berlin Wall has fallen. There have been global events which are innumerable. The oil prices, the Labour Party, the Republican Party, European Union was not there at that time in the way it is now. Everything. Tsunami came and went. 9/11 came and went. 26/11 came and went. Every conceivable event, political, economic, social, agricultural, weather-related, so anything you can think of has happened. When the rupee was weak, when the rupee was strong, 38 rupees also per dollar, 55 rupees per dollar, everything is incorporated in this line. This is not the Sensex. This is India for you. When you say the market discounts everything, this is what it means. If you are against this, then I promise you, you don't have faith in India's future. Because whatever is happening now, you know, we are all worried, this and that and Europe and economic growth and politics and presidential election. Okay, fine, much worse has happened, hasn't it? By the way, there is one history which is very useful to learn, economic history.
If you learn economic history and see the world's economic past for the last 300, 400 years, much worse things have come, including World War I, World War II, Nagasaki, blah, 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 blah. And on every occasion, we have come out of that crisis. So what's the big deal of what's happening today? In the context of your lifetime and my lifetime, what's the big deal? I'm talking about the next 20, 30 years. This pink trend line is the 32-year trend line for India's growth. When India was growing at 3%, 4% and we were very happy. When we grew at 9% and then we grew at 7% and everybody was crying. And now that we are growing at 5%, everybody is like, oh, given up. This pink line has a lot more history embedded into it. The new India that we know of today is maybe the last 10 years in this chart. Are you getting what I'm saying? What does this pink line tell you? A trend line, all of us know this. But what is its real meaning and real value? Let me zoom into this a bit, or I'll zoom into that a little while later. This trend line is telling you, in spite of every good and bad thing that has happened, this is what we have done and we have stayed on track. Okay? This line is 1st of January 2020. Let some more governments come and go. Let BJP and Congress kill each other. Right? Let Europe go to hell. It doesn't matter. For that pink growth line to break, you will need a major disaster. And I promise you that major disaster happens, half of you will not have jobs. Right? You will have a disaster of that scale. What is happening now is nothing compared to what is required to break that pink line. You have to really get the significance of that pink line.
India should become Greece.
India should become Greece, okay, well put. Chances of India becoming Greece or all the Naxals taking over Rashtrapati Bhavan or something, pretty remote. Or CPI, CPM coming back.
A war with China.
We've had a war with China, right? Came and went. So, that line intersects this line somewhere. It's out of the chart. So let's put it in. This number comes at the bottom here, so bottom right of your screen, you'll see a number. Can someone please read it? 40,000. Today we are at 17,000. 8 years from now, as far as the market is concerned, as far as I am concerned, 40,000 is the worst case scenario. Some of you at 40, 50,000 for 2030. 1 lakh for 2030, no? Alright. What about 2030? This line is for 2030. Right? Okay. So let's pull that in. Please read the number. 1.75 lakhs in 2030. 10 times what it is today. And this is a line which is loaded in favor of the past of 5% GDP growth. Even if we say, okay, fine, we are now back to that trend in the last 10 years, it's just a, you know, blip. It was a mistake. India can only grow at 5% sustainably. With all the political, global, everything built in, 1.75 lakhs is what the market is telling you, is what the market is telling me. By the way, 18 years passes pretty fast. Some of us here are a little older will understand this. Others who are only 25, 30, like, 18 years. I'm not talking about creating wealth day after tomorrow. You know, you go short something, go long something. That's all different. What about this? This is the big picture. Yes.
We've seen China grow at what? 10% for past 10 years or 15 years. How is China start against
let me come to that. What is China's chart doing? I can show you Germany's chart, I can show you America's chart, I can show you the Greek chart and all of that. Right? The point is this, when China was growing for 10-15 years much faster than we have been, what did the market do then? were you able to get out when the market told you to get out? When the chart told you China is going down, did you get out? Because we will also come down, there is no doubt about that. But will we come down in the next 10-20 years? That's the question. I have no way to predict and no one can predict. But stay with the market is all I am saying. Right? Now, that pink line, 1.75 lakhs, 1st of January 2030. You know what the green line is? The green line, as far as I am concerned, is the new India, which has liberalized, opened up, creating wealth in a way that has never happened in the past for the last 10-12 years. In my opinion, that pink line is more representative of where India is now than India has been. We have changed permanently. Right? If you look at the green line, it will give you a different set of numbers. In my opinion, and this is purely an opinion, I have a right to be wrong. Right? What's the number here? 65,000. 65,000, 1st of January 2020. What's the number in 1st of January 2030? 4.25 lakhs. If you go outside this session today and tell your friends and family, they'll ask you whether you took admission to NIMHANS again. Right? Just like you would not have believed when Sensex was at 2000 to go to 5000, none of us here actually believe that Sensex can also be at 4.25 lakhs. You and I are like, oh, it was at 22,000, 22,000, 8,000. You know what? The 2008 crash is this. That's the 2008 crash for you. A small issue in the bigger scheme of things. In the beginning I said, you know, I'm not going to have a session on TA. I'm not going to talk about trend lines. But you will invest into this or trade into this only if you have the faith that this is going to happen. And as far as I'm concerned, and I'm being very clear about this, if you feel that this is not going to happen, then somewhere you do not understand India's growth story. You fundamentally do not understand it. Too many of us sit in AC offices and in cities and we are not on the ground when you go around India to see what is actually happening. You drive on the golden quadrilateral and you are watching a movie in the car when you have gone to sleep. You want to go to a certain place, flight has become so cheap, so you just go from airport to airport. You have no idea what's actually happening and how wealth is being created. In a small town like Hassan, where my dad comes from, for the last 5 years, you've had BPO taxis running in the night just like Bangalore. It's a place which is not more than 3 kilometers by 3 kilometers, Hassan. Kannada speaking, BPOs. Telugu speaking, BPOs. You and I only see this English and completely miss the big picture. The reason Hindustan Unilever, ITC and all this consumption is happening in spite of whatever else is happening in the world is not because of urban India, it's because of rural India. But you know what, reading it in the newspaper is one thing. Going and seeing it and then connecting the dots back to the stock market is a completely different thing. My wife is here, right? I'll tell you where we went for a honeymoon, with her permission, right? Went to Goa, like most people. But one of the things we did in Goa, or rather I did in Goa, is we went to the industrial park there, on a honeymoon, on a Sunday. There is, I think, Panaji Industrial Park or something like that. The gate was open, just drove in. 5-6 kilometers of the straight roads and then side roads and then big buildings and blah 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 blah. And one day, if everything is closed, it's a Sunday. You see this Titan factory. The Titan factory is 3 times the size of a football field. Titan watches is written there. There's a transformer building outside, which is probably bigger than this hall and 3 stories high. I'm sitting there and calculating. To make a watch that you and I buy for 500, 2000 rupees, they have to put up this. Just just the building is a few hundred to 200 crores. The amount of equipment in it must be a few hundred crores. This thing is a 2000 crore project. If they took a loan, hundreds of crores they are paying as interest. How many watches do they have to sell to make that sort of money? Believe me when I say this, that when I talk like this, you don't get the impact. You have to see it with your feet, with your eyes, and then say, oh, this is why Titan stock is going up. That is where conviction happens, that is where faith happens. It does not happen in a classroom, it does not happen in this session, it does not happen through books. Right? How many of us are really prepared to play this game? Because you know what happened recently? Let me zoom in a bit. We were all saying market will fall, market will fall, market will fall, right? So those of us who know some basics of TA, what have you noticed here? Where did it bounce off from? The green line. Those pink line and green lines have been on my chart here for 2 years. I have not changed them one bit. I just review them once a month. Nifty will go to 3,700. Alright, fine. You know what? If Nifty goes to 3,700 or something, it will hit the pink line. Then what? You think that's going to break? Is that an opportunity or a curse? You need to have faith to do this. Just, oh, this is a trend line, it bounced off, is not enough. And by the way, a lot of wealth creation doesn't get much more complicated than this. It's as simple as this. But putting faith behind simple things is not so easy. All of us are used to complex this, that, blah, blah, blah. Software fellows, like thousands of lines of code, then only it will work. Yeah, simple thing, just one line. So, let's get back.
It's a 30 minutes or 1 hour daily chart. Should we need to weekly?
This is a weekly chart, get a monthly chart. How does it matter? Okay. By the way, you'll get the entire data on the BSE website. Nothing proprietary, it's nothing magic. It's there. So what are you going to do now that you know 2020, 2030? I'd really like to know. I really want all your addresses, phone numbers, permanent address please, not temporary address. I'll come, write to you on 2030 and ask you what you have done. Otherwise, just a good talk, that's it.
All will be rich.
God willing, let's see. I look forward to that. What will come in the way of you getting there? For you to get that 1.75 lakh Sensex or 4 lakh on the Sensex, what will come in there? What are the challenges and the impediments that you and I will face? Some of them are these. Data, a lot of us have. Information, a lot of us have. We are expert Google searchers. Ask anyone, well, I'll get you this data, I'll get you that, blah, blah. Alright, great. In Bangalore, we get a lot of data mining experts. But you know what? Data is not information. Information is not knowledge. Knowledge is not understanding, and understanding is not wisdom. Till you get all of these, you cannot act. To know fire is hot is not enough. You have to get the wisdom that it will burn you. And that will only happen if you experience it. There's no point telling people, you know, don't do this, don't, there's no point telling children, don't do that. They will do that. That's the only way human beings learn. How many software people here? Right? How many doctors here or biology background people here? Only one, two, me and her. Right? God did not hardwire human beings for the creation of wealth. Right? God hardwired human beings to have babies and to eat and to shit. That's it. You really want to create wealth? All the software in your head can't override the hardwiring. You'll have to do something even more than that. And you need guts to do that. So what will CMT do? This is what CMT is doing for me right now. Providing not only access to data and information, but giving me the knowledge that really makes a difference, that has been tested and verified by experts for last 30, 40 years. When I do CMT, I know that what I'm reading is good stuff, is stuff that is worth knowing, is stuff that is worth acting on. A lot of us have computer disks full of PDFs, correct? The first thing you do when you open a PDF is what? Look at number of pages. I read the book. Very good. It doesn't work. There's too much information and data out there. You and I need a structured method to acquire the knowledge. That is what CMT will do for you. They'll tell you, read this, read it in this sequence. These are the important topics that you need to know. And this is not some Ira Kaira fellow telling you, huh? These are people with tons of years of experience that you and I can never hope to get. They are telling you this. When I started out in the markets, it was extremely difficult because, you know, when you read a book, you read chapter 2, then you read chapter 5, and chapter 5 says something which may be different from chapter 2, and then you're all confused. Like, what is the right thing? Do you have access to the author? You don't. There came a point in my journey in the markets where I could quote from a book. I'm good at that, I can do that. But just because you can quote from a book does not mean you can do what you have to do. Sometime back when the markets fell, this was 5-6 years back, I knew I should exit the market, my long positions, blah 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 blah. But did I actually do that? No. Fear took over, greed took over. The only thing I remembered was God at that time. All the TA, FA went all out of the head. You need to then build understanding and wisdom, and that will come only with experience. Once you do all that, then you're set and you're on the way of creating something really meaningful. Till then, believe me, you don't have a chance. I did not have a chance. I think I'm starting to have a chance now. You know, it takes 10 years of school education and then 5 years of going to a degree college so that you can get a job. Correct? And then here we are talking about the stock market, and a lot of us think that we read a book here, do a course there, and then we start making money. Most people who buy stocks pay less attention to buying them and they pay more attention to buying tomatoes and potatoes. Seriously. Ask any average fellow, why did you buy that stock? What does the company do? What is the trend line saying? What is the chart? What are the fundamentals? Who is the management? Zero. It's like Warren Buffett said, if you read an annual report, you've done what 90% of the analysts don't do. It is quotes. Right? And here it is that you and I think we know. It's the most dangerous trap that when you think you know, because it's very difficult to correct that. You have to start off on a premise that you don't know. Before I got into CMT, I thought, oh, what I know is enough, I'm getting results, I have proof to show that I'm getting results. But it was, you know, chicken and mice game, all small, small trades here. You see something really strong. One thing I love about the markets, what stops you from buying 1,000 stocks instead of buying 10 stocks?
Fear.
Fear. Your analysis is the same, everything else is the same. Your guts are what are not there. And then that stock goes up. And I said, I should have bought 100. Okay, how about buying 100 now? If you think it's still going to go up, buy now. Buy in Hindustan Unilever. Don't hang me if it goes down. It will go down one day. Right? When the trend line breaks, get out. What comes in the way? You know, you have the knowledge, you have the experience. It's something deep inside. So, to touch upon what CMT's body of knowledge is. A lot of, you know, statements that we have heard of and we take casually. One of them, financial markets lead the economy. How come the stock markets are going up across the world in the last 1 week when the economies are just falling all over the place? Because see, there's a problem in our mind. Here we say economic conditions are bad, unemployment is high, GDP growth has gone down, Greece might, you know, just collapse the whole Eurozone, but the markets are going up. One of the things you will learn if you do CMT is how interconnected the world is and how much the markets can tell you about what is really likely to happen in the real world. The markets do lead the economy. in almost every sector. And you know what that happens? It gives you ample time to prepare for likely outcomes, opportunities, and adverse scenarios that can happen at any time. It will give you ample warning to protect, increase your wealth, take care of opportunities for yourself and for your family. How many of us think that 2008 crash was a surprise? Now everybody says, oh, CDO this, CDO that, blah, blah, blah. I'll show you something. Here is a chart of the Dow Jones. Right? The Dow Jones before the crash. Just let me make this a little easier. Right. So, I'm assuming that, you know, at least some of us have some basic knowledge about simple technical analysis. So, this is a chart from 2004, before the crash. How many of you heard of this thing called head and shoulders? Heard? Right? Okay. Head and shoulders is a pattern, if you see, especially after a big advance, signifies that the market is probably going to go down a lot. And if the head and shoulder confirms, I won't get into the technicalities, that if it confirms, then only you get out. Right? Okay. So, just to make this clearer, here is a head and shoulders on the Dow Jones before the crash. Trend line will break. If there's a head and shoulders, trend line were broken much earlier. Doesn't matter. Right? Let me see if I can make this clear. Right. Alright. So, for those of us especially who know, you know that this is where the head and shoulder, now a little clearer, this is the left shoulder. This is the head and this is the right shoulder. For those of you who are sitting there and thinking this guy is, you know, seeing pictures which are not there, hallucinating, well, just a matter of experience before you also start. This is not hallucination, this is real. Because you know what? Look at this date. What's the date is there? 4th of January 2008. Depending on how you draw that trend line, last second half of December, something between 20th December 2007 and the 7th January 2008, that trend line, neckline of the head and shoulders broke. And this is the head and shoulder which is one full year, 2007 to 2008. Before the Indian markets crashed, the Indian markets were peaking at this time. I can put the Sensex next to this. We were still at 22,000 and this had broken down. There is no question of being long in this market when you have a pattern like this and it breaks down. There is absolutely no question. If you know TA, this was a signal to hit the panic button and sell across the board. It did not matter what anybody was saying. And this has stood the test of time for 200, 300 years. What happened to the markets after that? You and I were, let's put the Sensex at that time. This is the Sensex at that time. If I get some more data on this, you have a very simple, a pretty regular pattern called a wedge. Right? And this is a rising wedge which was there. You can see it in the Nifty, you can see it in the Sensex, you can see it everywhere. When did this break?
21st January, 3 weeks after the Dow Jones broke, even if you had to walk from your remotest village to get the next internet connection so that you could sell, that was more than enough time. Now we blame all media, this and that. There were dharnas outside Bombay Stock Exchange, Chidambaram, hi hi. Chidambaram put a gun to your head and said, bhai, bhai, this is stuff you can do, this is stuff I can do. Why do you and I depend on somebody else? The thing is, you have to trust this and believe that it works. When did it break? What was the level? 19,000, 18,000. And when it was going down and it came down here, what were the jokers on TV saying? Buy. It has corrected by 3,000, 4,000 points. Good buying opportunities. I'm sure if you did not, you know people who bought. And then it went all the way down. Simple trend lines. If you had put a downtrend line, this was a primary downtrend line for the Sensex at that time. If you had put, if you know about downtrend lines in a falling market, you would have put actually this one also. That broke when the Sensex was 9,000 in March 2009. If you were a very conservative investor or a trader, you might have waited for this support or resistance to break. The Sensex was at 10,000 in April 2009. When all this happened, what were you and I doing? What were the media telling us? Some bounce, some this, some that, will go to 5,000, blah blah. What is technical analysis telling you? Buy. One exit here, everything in your stock market, dump it. One entry here, after 9 months. If you really read the good books, you'll see, you know, really good investors and traders, after they sell, they take a holiday. Because the next opportunity is not going to come this week or next week. It will take a long time for the market to settle down before it comes. 8 months holiday. If you had just put your money in FD at this time, it would have been better. But most of us were what? Hoping and praying. God gave this knowledge. If you and I don't use it, don't blame God after that. Because you and I have this. In India, we have karma. Your karma is that you don't know this. Not that you lost money. Okay? So, US gave you ample warning about what to do and when to do it. All that CTO, this came months later. Lehman came in September. Nothing. You just have to follow this. And there is nothing more than simple support and trend lines that have grown so far. And if you have that low theory thing about $1.9 million, that's all you need. But do you have the conviction? So, what will CMT do? Understanding and knowledge that is extensive, intensive and integrated. Because in today's world of overload of information and all of that, you do this, somebody else does some other analysis and somebody, oh, this is going up, you say it's going down, now you're confused, who to trust? And have you noticed something? You have an idea in your mind about what stock to buy and then you watch TV. You're waiting for some fellow there to say something. That fellow says, sell. And you give up all your opinions and deliver your fate to him. Because you think that he knows more than you. Why? Because he's on TV. You want to be on TV? Meet me after the session. I'll put you on TV. On CNBC, we'll put you. You can also say, analysts. Okay? The real analysts, believe me, are not on TV. Nothing personal against anyone. I know none of them.
give you a simple, you know, different example. Ratan Tata went and bought JLR for $2.2 billion. Then he went and bought, what was that steel company? Chorus for another few billion dollars. And all the jokers on TV said, bad buy, buy too many overheads, too expensive, blah 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 blah. Aye, very good. They know more than this guy who's putting his $2.2 billion. Very good. What happened the 1 year after those acquisitions happened to those companies' balance sheets, and what happened to those stock prices? Did anyone track that? And why was no one talking about it? Because 1 year after the integration of those companies happened, go and look at the balance sheets and go and look at the stock prices of both Tata Motors and Tata Steel, the way it shot up. You and I have given up responsibility for our own future. Right? You pay 300 rupees for cable TV and you think that will serve you. It will not. Stop watching TV. Unsubscribe, watch Cartoon Network. Much better. And by the way, you know, after you learn CMT, then you can watch all the blue channels. It's eminently fun.
Yeah,
it's eminently fun. After you learn, you watch them, it's a lot of fun. Right? So, anyway. So just to give you some idea of what all you will learn, and this is just from level 1. I have not yet done level 2. I have not yet done level 3. I hope to do that subsequently. But just from level 1, these are some of the things I have already started to learn. What do you really mean by market structure? Somebody said price action. What is price action? A lot of people use that term. Can you really explain it? Can you make a decision on the basis of that? Or is it just some theoretical knowledge that, oh, this is price action? All these terms mean really something profound and something actionable. That is what CMT is doing for me. Before that, I was like, I know this, I know that. But how do I really use it? What do I really do? So, what is market structure? What is intermarket analysis? What are cycles? Sentiment analysis? Contrarian investing, very popular term. But what really is contrarian investing? It's amazing what the books in CMT will tell you about contrarian investing. It is not what you and I hear in the media. Contrarian investing is about you knowing when to stay with the trend and when not to stay with the trend. It is not about buying what is not the favorite of the market. No, that is not contrarian investing. It's way beyond what is there that we know. Automated trading, for those of us who, you know, want to get into that, it will start introducing to the challenges, the pitfalls of automated trading. Then you'll really think, do I really want to do this when simple stuff like this can deliver results? Risk and money management. A lot of us use that term, but hardly do anything called risk management or money management in our trades or our investments. Statistics. How to use statistics for investing and trading. All of these theories you will learn in detail. It will be explained to you why that is the way it is. You know, I have a problem. My problem is this. If you tell me, press the accelerator, the car will go fast, it's not enough for me. I need to know what that wire does, what it does in the carburetor, then it does in the engine, and know this happens and blah, 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 blah. I am that sort of a person. What I have noticed is, you know, when things don't work the way they are supposed to work, that sort of knowledge makes a difference. Because you can diagnose. And then you can figure out whether it's a serious problem or it's not a serious problem. Is a trend line breaking or not breaking? One chapter will tell you it's breaking, another one will tell you it's not breaking. Who's right? Well, those are the times when you're confused, no? Should I enter now? Should I wait a little more? Will it go down? And then while you're waiting, it has gone up 10%. And you think, yo, next stop. All this drama is completely unnecessary. No theory will give you the finer points that make the difference. Sorry, not no theory. CMT will give you the finer points that make the difference to your decision making, to your confidence. You will learn everything right from the basics. to the advanced concepts in a structured step-by-step manner. There is lots of guidance and advice online. There are videos both on the ATMA website and on the MTA website. Unfortunately, we don't currently have, you know, a proper classroom experience in India as far as I know. But I think with ATMA's effort, this will change. And in the days and months to come, you will probably get that, you know, available to you. Some of us will be asking, obviously, at this point, how much will it cost you? Alright. To finish the entire CMT level 1, level 2, level 3, all charges included, it will cost you about $2,500. Right? So that's about 1.25 lakhs. And I also thought, 1.25 lakhs, oh, you so much money, what would I get? You know, Indian thinking. Can't help it. At 1.25 lakhs for anyone who's had a loss in the markets, right, or for anyone who has been completely confused as to what to do, is a very small price to pay if you're going to run for that 4.75 lakhs on the Sensex. Do it. And my sense is, I mean, I don't know anyone higher up, but my sense is, you know, as India has become an MTA member and lot of people in India are now doing CMT, it's just a matter of time before MTA hikes the price. Supply and demand, simple as that. So do it now. After I did the level 1, there's been a revision in the examination format for level 1. They're making it tougher. So, you know, welcome to the real world. You will learn what to do, when to do it, and most importantly, what not to do. Far too many of us, what should I do, what should I do, what should I do? A lot of times, what not to do is more valuable knowledge than knowing what to do. CMT will give you that. Right? CMT will tell you, look, this is an iffy situation, this is how you deal with it. CMT will tell you, look, this is unequivocally a buy or an unequivocal sell, just do it. You need that sort of conviction. See, the problem is, you know, take that exam, yeah. If you're going to go through CMT, there will be a lot of rigorous self-study. No classroom, no spoon feeding, no nothing. And all the good Indians that we are, I'm sure most of us here passed an exam just because we memorized the answers. All the guides that we bought and blah, 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 blah.
Last minute.
That was my approach for CMT also. Last minute I realized it will not work. I thought, let me read 10 pages in CMT. 10 pages took half a day. Where does 100 pages per day go? Out of the window. Let's better start now. Stop trading, stop doing everything and read only for CMT. For 6 to 8 weeks. If you approach CMT with the Indian mindset, I'll mug it up and pass, forget it. Don't even apply. CMT will test whether you understand the concept. The questions which are, it's an online exam for the level 1 and level 2. The questions that are just bouncers, some of them.
Is this new type or is it?
A lot of the answers will look similar. Okay, but there's only one right answer. In the exam that I did, there was one chart and that chart had 10 questions on it. On 10 different areas in this, on that exam. So like first 10 questions were something, then this chart comes, then okay fine, answer the question. After another 5, the same chart comes. Exactly the same chart.
But no.
Yeah, the question is different. Question is different, answer. What did I do? I go back and check if that was right or not. After another 5, the same chart again. Same chart came 10 times, I promise you. There is one oath we are supposed to take that we will not reveal about the exam, so I can't say much more. But one chart, 2 hour exam, 45 minutes, go. I finished the level 1 with 20 seconds to spare. Because some of those questions were just real bounces. Because it does not check your memorization, it doesn't check your this or that, it checks your understanding. That is the level of those questions. If any of you have done any of these professional certifications, American style, you know what I'm talking about. They don't care whether you can, you know, give a definition. They really care whether you know. And they've designed their questions that way. Level 3, essay writing, human checked. No computer checking. Level 1, level 2 is an online thing. Level 3 is also online, but the answers are reviewed by CMTs with 10 to 20 years of experience in New York. Blindfolded, they don't know who they're testing, right? And each part of the quest exam will be marked by a different set of people. If you match up to their standards, you will get through. If you don't, then redo it. Simple as that. Right? So it is, I'm really glad that I did it. Because it put me in my place, quite honestly. After you do all this, so what happens? This is where you get your confidence. This is where you get your trust. This is when you know that you know. When I was reading books on technical analysis, because there's really no one to teach who you can really trust who knows, it's very difficult to find that in India. There's always this doubt, okay, I've read the book, do I really know? That is when I realized this value of an examination and a certification. Because you know what, for us in India, certification is a piece of paper that you can apply for a job with. You'll go to Avenue Road and get it, some of us. Right? If I get 35% and get that certificate, enough. That is not the purpose of an exam. The purpose of an exam is not for the certificate. Because you and I look at the certificate and say, see, now I can show the world what I know. No, the purpose of an exam is to tell you that you know. Get that? The purpose of an exam is to tell you that you know, to certify to you that look, you're competent to do this task. And when somebody senior, somebody who has done research, an institution like MTA does that, and you know that you have reached that level of competence, it does a lot to your confidence, to your trust, to your ability to take calls, to invest larger sums than you were before. You will no longer start thinking, oh, only 10 shares. There's a very clear line, 4.7 lakhs on the Sensex. Let me find all the money I can buy, find on the FDs and wherever else and buy Nifty Bs and leave it. Please think about it. 17,000 on the Sensex right now, worst case scenario, 1.75 lakhs. 10 times more, every 1 lakh that you have now will be 10 lakhs. What does that mean to your life? What does that mean to your family? And all you have to do is buy Nifty Bs, nothing else. Let's talk about trading and intraday some other day. Can you take the big step? CMT will allow you to take that big step. I've been hesitating so far. Now I know that, okay, fine, you can. Why? Because somebody accomplished said that. That's why you need a guru. All of us have lost this gurukul system in India. No? The purpose of a guru was to get you there in all areas of your life, in your thinking, in your being. CMT is the closest that comes to that, at least as far as TA is concerned. So what will you do? Tell me one thing. What can price do? Okay. So that's the result. What can price itself do? Anything else? What does price do? On an everyday basis, on a weekly, monthly, whatever, what does price do? No, you've seen those t-shirts that kids wear. I was born a genius, then I went to school. Our education ruined you. All intelligent people, you and I. I did MD also. Price goes up, price goes down, or price stays flat. What else does it do? I didn't ask why. I said, what does it do? That is up to you. Price didn't do that. You did that.
The thinking of people.
Price goes up, price goes down, or price goes sideways. That's all. Does it do anything else? If it goes up, what should you do? If it goes down, what should you do? If it stays flat, what should you do? How many of us know that there are techniques to make money in all these three scenarios? When the market goes up, go long. When the market goes down, short it. When the market is flat, sell options. Correct? Very easy to say, no. But how do you implement it? You need two things. First, you need to be able to know what the price is likely to do.
That's why you need TA. Is it going up? Is it going down? Is it going to stay sideways? And when will the trend change? Because anything and everything changes. So you should recognize that change also. By the way, people have strategies which are, you know, fixed. You will not succeed in the long term. I am not saying this, CMT will say this. It will prove to you, no strategy works forever. In any state of market, you need to have different strategies for different states of the market. Nobody is going to come and whisper in your ear, but this is the new state of the market. You are going to have to be able to see it. Then you are going to have to be able to adapt and say, look, what I have been using for the last 5 years is not going to work anymore. I need to change my approach, my technique. You need to do that. CMT will get you there. CMT is getting me there. Right? Now, if you can recognize what the market is going to do, and it does only three things, agreed? And you know that there are techniques to make money in all the circumstances, then what comes between you and making money? What comes between you and making money? Only you. In the normal life that we live, we have a lot of excuses for why you did not achieve something. Economy is bad. Boss did not promote me. I couldn't get a visa to go abroad. You know, guess what? You get yourself to that level, CMT will do for you, then you don't have any excuses for not producing results. Because it is not circumstances that will determine whether you make money or not. What will determine is whether you read the circumstances right, whether you read the markets right, and then whether you implement the appropriate strategy for that. Are you getting what I'm saying? You will run out of excuses, and by the way, that's not a nice place to be in life. Because the only person who can blame you after that is you. And a lot of us are very happy finding blame outside, no? After giving you this talk, maybe 10 years or 20 years from now, if I have not made a few crores, then who failed? Who failed? Musa failed. Marcus didn't fail. Musa failed. Musa did something stupid. Musa made a blunder. Or the last thing that can come in your way, if your karma is really gone, then well, there's nothing I can do about it. If your past life was like messed up, then I don't know. By the way, there's a video on YouTube. University of California, Berkeley, UCLA, Los Angeles, right? There's a talk between the Dalai Lama and the dean of that university, and the dean is an ex-investment banker, one of the big investment bankers in the US. And in the introductory remarks, the dean says, I forget his name, you know, obviously I must have messed up my past life, that's why I was born an investment banker in this life. You will run out of excuses why you don't have wealth in your life. You can't say gold fell. Because by the way, gold falls. How many of you know that? No? Because a lot of people are buying gold, no? You know the history of gold? You know that it was $600 per ounce in the 1970s and it became $200 per ounce in the 1980s and it stayed at 200 for 30 years after that. Because it's a huge public thing right now, buy gold. Yeah, fine, if I quote 50,000 per 10 grams in India, I'm not saying no. But the day will also come and it will fall, and then we'll see how many of the retail people will sell. We'll see how many of the gold shops will buy a gold bag at that time. Because when it happens, nobody will buy it from them, so they will not buy it from you. Be prepared. It may happen next week, after 6 months, after 6 years, I don't know. But I will follow the gold chart, and the gold chart will tell me when the rise is over. Okay? The last point on this slide. There is enough data, please look it up on the net. There is the American Association of Investors, of Retail Investors. There is something called Better Investing, something called Morningstar, and they have researched, and they do this America. One of the good things about America is they are thorough in their research and their service. And you can get a lot of good authenticated data. And this is what has been shown universally, and I'm sure some of you know people like this.
that professional individual investors and traders routinely beat market professionals as far as returns go. Routinely, and when I say routinely, for 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, those who have taken the market seriously. By the way, when I say take the market seriously, I'm not saying quit your job, I'm not saying give up everything else in life, I'm not saying become a day trader, no. Learn to that level that you can then apply in a confident manner. Then whether you're on a golf course, or you're coding the whole day, or you're in Goa, or I don't know, becoming lazy in front of a TV, that's your choice. Take it seriously, it can change your life. So just some things to point out to close this. These are not my quotes, these are quotes I picked up from the books that I read for CMT. If incorrect decisions are being made, they will almost always come from a position of mental imbalance. Who's your mental imbalance? Yours, not the markets. If you are making losses, it is not because the market is wrong, it is because something is wrong with you. Acknowledge that first, then only you can set it right. Because we are too caught up in saying, oh, I thought it was a good company, see this and see that, but the market went down. Market will go down, what did you do when the market went down? I missed that opportunity, why? I was tracking that stock, but doesn't work. There's a guy called Martin Pring, some of you have read his books, right? He has listed 19 points to identify a primary top. The primary top is a multi-year, 22,000 on the Sensex in 2008, that was a primary top. 8,000 on the Sensex in September of 2008, that was a primary bottom. That is when in the primary top you sell, on the primary top you buy, and you sell big and you buy big. He has given 19 specific, separate, independent points to identify what is a primary top, and he's given 14 separate points to identify what is a primary bottom. How many do you know? And how many of us label this in retrospect and say, oh, that was too late? Can you say this is? Because that's what makes the difference. This is just at level 1. Hopefully I'll be back after I do level 2 and then level 3 if Jagdish invites you. Let's discuss. The academic world and the world of rarefied Wall Street or Dalal Street strives madly to quantify everything in life except the risks and liabilities that they themselves create for their customers. And this is exactly what's happening in the world today. The financial institutions have created risks for the entire world. But the financial institution says, we didn't do it. This is not our risk. We didn't create this. How come? Let us seek simpler methods to quantify the risks of individual stocks and the portfolios they reside in, knowing all the time that absolute precision is impossible. Not my quotes, this is again from Edwards and Meggie. When asked for secret to success, time and again you will hear famous traders say discipline. What is discipline? Do we have an actionable definition or some dictionary definition? Think about this. What they mean by discipline is the ability to measure and contain the risk, set a stop loss based on technical or money management procedures, and then honor that stop loss. How many of you put stop loss and then change it? Who's going to put it on change? I've done that. Right? CMT will tell you why you need to do all this. In the modern times, this, you know, fill it and shut it approach, even the Sensex 4.75 lakhs, should we just buy it and forget about it for 18 years? I don't think so. There will be times when you come down, you should get out, then re-enter. That getting out, getting in might be weeks and years apart, but so be it. The best technical analyst opinion in the modern times today is that even long-term investors should not grin and bear a bear market. 22,000 happens, you saw the head and shoulders on the Dow Jones, you saw the wedge, rising wedge on the Nifty, get out. when you saw the reversal happen, get back in. If you had gotten out at 22,000 and got back in at 10,000, you avoided destroying half your wealth. And then you got in for the same stock at half the price. And then it went back to 22,000. What does it mean in terms of wealth? And this is just the last 5 years. By the way, bear markets, are they normal or abnormal parts of market behavior?
Normal.
How many bear markets did it take you to understand that? That they are normal? Because the first bear market is always abnormal for everyone, I know. It shouldn't have happened. Then after some time, when you get a few, too many right here, and you say, oh, this is life.
Sometimes we wish that very little bit back. Oh,
yeah. By the time, all the head is wet. Right? Those who buy this, follow this hold approach forever, this is applicable for who? Only for bank trust investments. Right? And the large state firms which cannot afford to offend their investment banking clients by suggesting that their retail customers should sell. If the retail customers start selling at the peak, who is going to buy from them? Who is selling at the peak? The smart guys. Now, if all the retail guys become smart, then those smart guys will have a problem. It won't happen. That's not how life works, but still. So this is the sample list of just things that you will learn, right? Maybe these are topics that ATMA can take up for future sessions, right? Cycles, theory and uses, how to implement them. This is from a book called Kirkpatrick and Thal, chapter 19. Stop losses, what are the different types, why should you use them? How many of us have the experience, you put a stop loss, it comes only to your stop loss and then it goes up? No? Then you stop putting stop losses. And then it comes there, it doesn't go up. And I should have put stop losses. And then at least I have gone through 3 or 4 cycles of this because I said stop loss, definitely. Whatever happens to stop loss. There is no perfect method. All of us are looking for the perfect method, that holy grail. It's not there. What CMT will tell you, look, there are these dozens of methods. This is how this works, this is how that works. And from your experience, you will choose and select, okay, this is what I'm going to use. Why is trading so difficult? A lot of people who get in think trading is easy, right? We'll make money. And then only after experience you realize that it's not so easy. CMT will give you a perspective. Why is it so difficult? You may even think about not trading after you do CMT. So be warned. Good decision. That's better to save your capital than start losing it. What about neuroscience, psychology, emotions and trading? How do they impact you and how to overcome them? Psychology is a big part of CMT. There are 5 ingredients for market analysis. I won't get into the details. Right? Each one has its own relevance. But all 5 work together simultaneously in the markets. How many do we know? What about money and risk management? Just not concepts, but the nuts and bolts. How to actually do this? Why that number? Why should you not risk more than 2% of a trade? There's a straight logic to it. Stock selection. How do you select a stock? What's the logic? Not your logic. Market's logic. Not the RBC, remember. By the way, that RBC that came out of this pinprick, what happened to it?
Died.
Died. What happened to the market? It continued. Who is the RBC?
Me.
I have to be careful.
System training, do you really want to get into it? And I'm not talking in some sophisticated computerized thing that you need to learn coding skills. Simple system training, what does it take? How do you implement it? How do you test it?
How do you, you know, back test it? How do you walk forward? How do you check? How do you know when that system is not working? All this is there. Checkpoint for primary peaks and bottoms already discussed. Ergonomic trading. What is ergonomics? Yeah, I bought a standard nice office table from one of the good shops. And 3 months after using it, I'm getting this shoulder pain and neck pain and all of that. It's the standard table. Everything is perfect about it. everything, okay, something is wrong with me. Got x-ray, did physiotherapy, it was okay for him, it's back. Then my accident happened to go to a friend's office, and his table was suddenly much lower than mine. I'm wondering, maybe this is the issue. That guy had a severe back pain, and so he got everything customized. He said, look, this is what I did, blah, 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 blah. And I got that table made to my requirements. The next week, I went and chopped that leg of the table. Very painful, because you paid a lot of money, so, you know, stupid Indian that I am sometimes, but that small thinking, paid so much, chopped the wood now. But did it, and that pain has never come back. What is it to do with training? All my systems sit on that table. And if I have neck pain when the market is going on, you think I am concentrating on the market? Well, it's a simple thing like that, or something a lot more detailed, wherein you have to really understand what techniques work for you, what is your level of alertness, how sharp are you at reacting to things, do you want to do something on an end of day basis, do you want to just have a regular job and then do this on a weekly basis. These are all questions you have to ask and find answers to. Nobody can give it to you. But CMT will give you enough to think about and get those answers. After CMT, what will you do when you have that higher level of confidence? You will take positions with confidence. You will play for the big moves. You will have staying power in the markets when they don't go with you temporarily. But you will also know that, okay, this is just a small correction and it's likely to go back up. You will also know that, okay, fine, my opinion is wrong and I should get out. You will let your profits run and cut your losses. You have heard this hundreds of times, but it's a completely different thing to implement. For those of you who made big losses and small profits, you know exactly what I'm talking about. You will learn this not from the market but from CMT, because it will show you what it really takes to succeed in the markets. You will learn patience, you will learn to be humble with yourself and the markets, you will accept defeat and victory with equal measure. The problem is this, you buy the stock, it goes down and you feel you made a mistake. There's a difference between you making the mistake and the decision being wrong. You and the decision are not the same thing. If you measure yourself with the results that you get in the markets, I promise you, you're going to die very soon. You want to die quickly? BP, heart attack, start trading. You have to be able to separate who Musa is and what is Musa's decision. CMT will give you some, you know, perspective on that. In many ways, I am not joking when I say this, one small step towards nirvana. Live more, worry less. I'll end with some life lessons very shortly, right? You and I use this word will in life a lot. I will do this, the market will go up. There's a problem with that statement. All of you say loudly, I will make money in the market.
I will
say this, I'm likely to make money in the market. What are the difference? Do you feel different when you say it? Are there different thoughts in your head when you say it?
I didn't say it.
Then you didn't get it. Right? When you say will in life, you close out all other possibilities. This is the only thing that can happen as far as you are concerned. I will be on time. This clock will go up. But guess what? Life doesn't work that way, no? The only person who can say I will is God. Think about it. The only thing you and I can do is do our best. And to that extent, the only correct statement is I am likely to make money on this trade or position. What that does for me when I phrase it like that in my head is that I'm open to the possibility that this stock could do something else. Then I'm open to the possibility that I may have plan A, plan B and plan C and I have to actually implement a different plan than the one I want. You can implement only if you start by being open in the beginning. If you're stubborn and I say I will, when that doesn't happen, see how you resist it, how you blame yourself and how you say market is wrong. The market has taught me one thing.
Life is such. Life is such. The gurus have said this. You read any, you know, spiritual book, you meet any wise person, they will tell you. That is life, but you and I don't accept. Markets will teach you that lesson. There is this inshallah story that I like. And inshallah means if God wills. Right? So I had this professor of ophthalmology when I was in St. John's. And he quit St. John and he went to the Middle East. He came back after 1 year and met him, so I went to tea, he and I. And it was a really interesting experience. That was the first time I gone to the Middle East. So, you know, whenever I gave appointments, everybody says, 4 p.m., okay, inshallah. 5 p.m., okay, inshallah. They don't say yes, they don't say no. So I don't know whether he's coming or he's not coming. Should I give the appointment to somebody else? Or just, what should I do? It took him 3 months to realize that when in the Middle East somebody says inshallah, they light up. It's their way of saying, yes, I am coming, but if God really wishes something else for me, then I'm sorry. And it is such a true statement. If God really wishes you not to be here or to be late, in spite of your best efforts, there's nothing you can do. In India, we use inshallah very differently. If a Muslim says inshallah to you in India, he's trying to say no politely. He doesn't have the guts to say to your face, that's all. You'll come for the wedding? Inshallah. Inshallah means, you know, if somebody lifts me from my couch, puts me in my car, and then brings me to your table, and then puts food in my mouth, then I will come. That's a corruption of that word. And it taught me more about life that way. So when I do a trade now, or when I do anything, that inshallah has a very different depth and meaning to it. It always had that, except that I didn't understand it. Likely to. Yes, I will do my best studies on TA or FA or whatever, but can I still lose money? If the same setup and the pattern comes for the next trade, will I trade or will I not trade? That is the real test. Because nowhere in life and nowhere in the markets was it said that you do this, 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 you're guaranteed to make money. Find that solution. That's what a lot of us are looking for.
It takes a while to understand, it doesn't exist. I have also ran behind the Holy Grail. Doesn't happen. Body of evidence and probability. Trend line is going up, support or resistance. What is the difference between proof and evidence? What is the difference? No one?
Proof is past.
Proof is something that you cannot dispute, right? It nails the decision. There is no contention about it. This roof has fallen, it's down there. Proof, it's gone, it's not there. There's some crack in it. There's some evidence that it may be falling, but will it fall? Maybe, may not, it might just be a superficial plaster crack. Evidence does not mean it will happen. Guess what? That's exactly what the markets and the chart will do. They'll only give you evidence. But you and I confuse proof and evidence. There is no proof in the market that it will go up. There is no proof in the market it will go down. There's only evidence that it is likely to do this. And that is the only thing you can do. Check for probabilities, balance your body of evidence, and be on the side of where the evidence points. If the evidence is pointing to markets going up, be long. If the evidence is pointing to markets going down, be short. Can the evidence be wrong? Yes. But it is rarely wrong. If the evidence is strong, then the proof is almost always there. Like they say, no, no fire without smoke, or no smoke without fire, whatever it is. If there is smoke, some fire is there somewhere. That's what the charts will do. Patience and waiting. That $100 to 1.9 million will teach you to wait for the right time to trade, for the right setup to come, for the evidence to be strong, for the probability of profits to be high, then only you will commit your money, not before that. One of the quotes from one of the books, a mouse can go where an elephant can't. What does it mean? Individuals can do many things that institutions cannot.
You can reverse positions without affecting the market, the institution cannot. You can be in a mid-cap or a small-cap stock, institutions cannot be. One of the things I put up there was V-Guard. The reason I put up V-Guard is there is somebody in the Bangalore Investors Club who is more of a fundamental analyst. Right? If you look at V-Guard's fundamental data, it is an extremely expensive stock fundamentally. But technically, it's a straight uptrend. It's making life highs day on day. So we have this debate. Should you buy? Should you not? The charts are saying buy. If the world is saying, you know, I want to put my money here, people are buying land left, right and center Devanahalli. Simple question. Where is the water in Devanahalli? If you build a house there, then you have to put what? You have to put what? Borewell. And what else? The septic tank. That septic tank water goes where finally? So what are you drinking? And you really believe the government when they say Kaveri water will come there after 10 years? Fundamentals. But people are buying. Should you buy if you are a speculative realist? Yes, buy. Don't fight the market. Wait, the bubble will also come. At that time, are you ready to exit? Be ready. CMT will teach you that. Markets will teach you this. So, last one or two slides. Anyone can do this. Whatever I've shown you today is you don't require formal education. You don't need to know English. You just need to have eyes that work. That's all charts need. You need to understand what that line represents, like that Sensex. It's not just a line, it's India there. So you have to know what it means. Then only you will act. So you have to put in the time and effort to learn. You will need to have patience to get that experience. You will have to learn from your mistakes. And you will have to learn every day. When people come to BIC for some of our courses, I tell everyone this. Whatever fees you pay BIC, you will pay multiples of that to this market. Then only you will learn. So, don't worry about it. You will pay anyhow, even if you don't do a course. But even if you do a course, you will still have to pay. That's all. Then, allow life to provide you with its abundance. What is this? What is this? Who is giving it to you? What is the guy doing? He is not taking it. He is not taking it. He is just looking and saying, what's the catch? If I take it, what will happen? One of my favorite lines. How many of you spiritual? Not religious, spiritual. Have you really read your holy books? Most of us just parrot. Go to a mosque, do yoga and come back. Go to a temple, go round and come back. Right? Go to a church, kneel and come back and look at who is around you. That's all we do. I want to learn all of you. Read the scriptures. And what do the scriptures say? And I challenge you to refute this. Whichever holy book you read, it is there. God said, I put all the resources you need in your life to have a good life on this earth before I put you here. God did not say that I put you and the resources in the same place. He didn't say that. That's your job, that's my job. If you can connect to the resources, the abundance will come. It's just a question of the mind. It's an attitude. It's the way you live life. As far as I'm concerned, the markets are the way. It's your access to wealth way beyond what you and I need and can imagine. If you practice the rules of the markets the way they should be, not the way you want them to, that's the big issue. Right? So, with that, my thanks to all of you for listening. I hope it's been food for thought. I am personally looking for, you know, co-passengers on my journey, so that it's not going to be an easy journey, it's not going to be a short journey. There will be a lot of learning to do. But if we can learn together, support each other, learn from each other's mistakes, When you read a book, often you will miss one finer point or you will miss reading a line. Somebody else will say, you know what, that is there. I know it will make a difference to everyone. So I invite you to look at the CMT journey, I invite you to look at the markets journey, and I invite you to look at what it can do for your life. I'd like to thank Jagdish for the invitation to speak to you at ATMA-India. And definitely like to thank Sushit Hedia, because I think without his initial interactions with me, he didn't push me, he didn't say you have to do it and all of that. But it was good to hear from somebody very senior and somebody very accomplished as to what is possible. Because you know, there are a lot of questions. I'm not looking for a job after I do CMT. So I said, why? What do I do? He clarified a lot of those things. Right? So I owe my thanks to him for the CMT and for being here. Right? That's our website. That's my contact information. If there's anything that you'd like to get in touch with me in the future about, please feel free. Right? Thank you very much. And if there's any questions, please put them on.
How do we register for the CMT?
Go to the MTA website, right? MTA.org, or Jagdish might be able to. Go to the MTA website and
everything is online, the registration. Payments are to be made by credit card. There is no other way you make a payment, and it's all instantaneous. There is really no problem. If you mess up with your registration procedure for some reason, you will have to call CMT directly in New York and give them your credit card number on the phone. You know, some people have to worry about that, but it's okay. Just do that. So your initial cost will be the $300 registration annual membership. Then there is I think $250 registration for the CMT. And then that's for the CMT program registration. Then each level has a separate fee. So level 1 is $250. Level 2 is $450, level 3 is $450 as of now. So your initial cost is $300, annual membership $250, CMT registration another $250 for level 1. The next exam is on I think October 22nd. 20th, thank you. For some crazy reason that I have not been able to figure out, the center, Prometric Center in Bangalore is full. 6 months in advance. So you have to go to Delhi or Bombay or Chennai or Hyderabad. I think Calcutta is also there.
Actually, I have contacted them. They cannot
hold their
site.
The exam happens. Correct, the exam happens. So Prometric Bangalore is closed on Saturdays, which is, I don't understand why. I mean, it's crazy. So, anyhow, whatever it is, you don't have a choice. You will have to go to either Chennai or Hyderabad. That's the closest. Register early because. Like the center in Chennai, I went there, it had only 10 cubicles. So there are only 10 exams that can be done. So and the Prometric does exams for all, some hundreds of institutions across the world. So somebody is doing some CNET exam, and somebody is doing some HR exam, and somebody is doing some medical entrance exam on it and all. So if you don't register early, you will not get a start, then you have to run around somewhere else. I wrote to CMT and said, look, Bangalore is not available, can you make some other option and ask for a Monday, etc. And they refused. They said, I'm sorry, Saturday we have to do it tomorrow.
Contacted only once a year?
Twice a year.
Comfort. So comfort and ergonomics, of course, go together. What tends to happen is we always do take positions, sometimes looking at your neighbor. And taking bigger positions is because he can manage risks more. You know, it's like what we do. I cannot eat how much my neighbor does, right? He likes something, I like something, and so we are very, very unique. And I think CMT will definitely give you the conviction to know what is good for you, and you can definitely go for it. Dr. Musa, extraordinary. It was really good, and really, I think we've extended all boundaries of time. I can see the audience is hungry for much more. And hungry for, of course, we have to have slight, light refreshments after this. We'll just end with the Janagana Mana. And after that, I'll play the CMT video for you so that you'll have an idea. A lot of questions which you'll have can be answered. You can bring in your plates and you can sit down. You're not allowed to bring in your plates. So possibly after you finish, you can come in and have an idea. What we are planning to do is also have a center here where, you know, people, like-minded people who would like to meet, you know, can meet more often. This, of course, is an educational meeting which happens once a month, where, you know, we just explore different avenues of technical analysis. But for more focused and serious traders who would like to take it up as a profession, technical analysis, and, you know, look at doing CMT, we are looking forward to having a study circle so that people can share information, books, ideas, and learn together, because then, you know, ultimately knowledge is power, and let's all get powerful about that. So thank you, Dr. Musa, and now I'll just request our audience, of course, before we do anything, once more, a big round of applause for Dr. Musa. May I now request Mr. Rajal of Spider Software, a software which I've been using from decades and literally cannot do without, to give a small token of appreciation on behalf of ATMA. Sir, can you please come? Indeed, our pleasure, and we just end with the national anthem. Will you all rise for it?